recorded at Medicines from the Earth in June of 2016. For more information on our conferences, lecture notes, books, and recordings, visit our website, botanicalmedicine.org.
So today's talk, I want to really cover some ground, and since I have the time, I want to do a little bit of work on the physiology aspect of things, make sure that we really have a deep understanding of the system we're talking about, right? We're talking about the digestive system in the human body, and I want to get really deep into that system, both on a physiological level and on a structural level and neurological level, and then also on an emotional level. And that's going to take some time, but it's going to be good because it's fun. I've got lots of good pictures and good fun things to show you guys. So once we get through that, I want to talk about how we assess problems with the digestive system and how those manifest in all the other systems of our bodies, especially, of course, the neurological system, which is the topic of this talk. How does our nervous system directly relate to our digestive system? And then we'll move on to some, you know, diagnostic techniques and some tools, some ways of identifying things. I really want to get into the dietary piece of it because, you know, as herbalists, as people who work with botanical medicine, you know, foods are just another layer of botanical medicine. They're just a little bit milder in their action, but they're still herbs. They still are medicine for us. So we understand the dietary aspect in order to really help our patients. And one of the big things is, you know, understanding what are the insults in our diet and in our world, and how do we remove those from our patients in a way that doesn't make their life too difficult to manage? A lot of times people have a hard time. You know, you give them a suggestion, a recommendation, it's taking away something from their life, something they're used to, or it's adding something they're not used to, a flavor or something. And we want to get to the point where we can help people understand what's the value in those changes and why, and if we can coax people and convince people to make the changes we know will help them, then we're doing them a big service. And then our herbs, of course, come in as another layer. That's a deeper layer of medicine, and all of our nutrients and things like that. So we'll get through all of that, and then at the end of it, I want to talk about some kind of highlights, some kind of spotlight things that I think are fun and things that will hopefully be really helpful and useful to you guys. And feel free to ask questions. I want to make sure that this talk ends up giving you tools. I'm assuming that most of you are treating patients and helping friends and family, you know, get well in this challenging world. So that's the goal, okay? Okay, so I'm just going to go ahead and go right to the first slide here. So one of the things that I like to bring to everything I do in medicine is taking an ecological approach to what we do. And from the roots of traditional Chinese medicine, the basis of medical thought wasn't based on a microscopic analysis. It was based on an observation of the natural world, how things interrelate outside of us, what we can see, what we can perceive. And that's everything from, you know, the insects that we notice outside, the pollinators, the trees, what we might see seasonally changing here in our environments, in our ecosystems, flows of water, flows of wind, places where things grow or things don't grow. How do they grow? How do they grow together or not together? And then starting to see the patterns and recognizing those patterns. And then looking to the stars, looking to our solar system, look at the planets, looking at the movements and the patterns, the timing. And then applying those thoughts and those principles that we've understood by observing the natural world and applying those into the body. And using the body as a microcosm of the macroscopic view. And that's super important for me. And it's something that I think, you know, we're having a really hard time reconciling in the world today. And it's something that I've kind of directed a lot of my life force at this point, is to try and help bring the two worlds together. The world that looks at the small things and the world that looks at the big things. And try to make them all work together. So this tree here is an example of the symbiotic relationship we see. You know, we observe the tree, and the tree lives either healthily or poorly, not based on only the sunlight and the wind and the water and the surrounding plant life, but of course, in a huge regard, based on what's happening below the soil. And what is the soil, and what's the soil composed of? And what lives in the soil? That's what's really, really important, and that's what I want to get into in this first section of the talk, is how important is that soil? You know, we know that there are nitrogen-fixing bacteria now that make nitrogen available for this tree, right? We know that there are mycorrhizae, small fungi that run in long sheets and have long tendrils like webs that connect organisms that are living in the soil together, supplying them with nutrients and water. This is what makes that tree a viable life form in this location. Without those forces, without those other life forms, the tree doesn't live. The tree doesn't live in the soil. It lives in the communities and colonies of microbes that inhabit its roots, at the interface between its roots and its soil. Okay? And I want to just make the analogy right away that we're talking about a sessile autotroph here, right? A non-moving plant that lives in one spot and gets all of its nutrients from the things that it can touch, where it can derive its source of energy, its source of nutrients. It's just right there. And so all it can do is make chemical compounds and interact by changing its chemical structure to interact with the world around it. Well, we aren't very much different, actually. We are basically the same thing. We're just kind of flipped inside out. We move. We're you know, mobile bipeds, right? We cruise around the planet. And instead of sitting in the soil with our roots down in it, we have roots inside of our bodies. And we have a hollow tube. And inside that tube are villi. And on those villi are microvilli. And inside those relationships at the microvilli are countless microbes that live in the soil that we choose to bring into our body, which isn't really in our body. Remember, it's a separate container. It's really outside our body. It's just inside of us from where we can see. It's a hollow tube. It's external. And it's an interface for us with our soil. So the soil that we bring into our bodies is just as important as the soil that makes this tree either healthy or not healthy. Okay? So there's a simple analogy that just helps us understand how we aren't that much different from the other life out here, and we've all evolved with the same principles, and we just have evolved in a different way. We're able to move and carry our soil with us. So just another idea here, you have kind of nature in our mind, you have the human form within nature, early Taoist perspectives, the idea basically that as within, so without, as without, so within. And that goes really deep and really far, because what we think inside of our bodies is affected by what's happening outside of us. We can see that in the world around us now. I mean, how much of us are affected by politics today? How much of us are affected by the news and the violence, the things that we see? How much are you affected by when you go take a walk in the forest? How does that affect how you think, how you feel? When you sit down and meditate, you know, what we do outside, externally, what we observe, what we experience has a huge effect on what's happening to us inside. And the things that we put into our bodies, the things that we do to ourselves, those things are reflected in what we do to the world. The way we attack a cancer and we annihilate it with strong weapons and we radiate things, we use nuclear medicine. Well, that's how we deal with terrorists or our enemies. We nuke them, we bomb them, we get them out, we destroy them. That's how we act. How do we act in nature in the world? Well, we cut it down, we strap it down, we tie it down, we push it back. Civilization pushes out and controls nature. Well, that's how it's starting to happen in our bodies. We're doing the same thing. We use drugs. We use all kinds of compounds that just suppress or kill or, you know, somehow control the environment inside of our bodies. Welcome. And we're manifesting diseases outside of our body in our world around us. The extinction of our species. How many species go extinct now every day? It's astounding what happens. Well, the same thing's happening in our bodies, guys. Those microbes, this incredible network is going extinct, just like at the external, all the animals are going extinct. And this process of external and internal playing off of each other is what's bringing us to the realization that cancer is the disease of our time. We're acting like cancer. What is the main tenet of cancer? It's uncontrolled growth. What are we doing? We're growing uncontrollably. There's no care for the host. We don't care about the host. Some of us do, but for the most part, I won't use any names, but people out there are really just concerned with progress, human progress, and it doesn't really occur to them that human progress depends on Earth, Gaia, progress, and that we are one and connected with the consciousness of this planet, and that its life is our life. So the metaphors of cancer and humanity go deep, and you know, all kinds of different ways to look at cellular transformations, the functioning of the cancer cell, metabolic defects, what we choose to do, how we choose to eat, how we choose to live. But that's really a topic for another talk, and hopefully I can entice you all to join me in that talk at some point down the road. There's a really nice Taoist saying I was going to just throw out to you guys. In dwelling, live close to the ground. In thinking, keep to the simple. In conflict, be fair and generous. In governing, don't try to control. In work, do what you enjoy. In family life, be completely present. And having a little one-year-old's really brought me to that, and the joy of being present with family. So we don't need to fill our heads with stuff, with information. We really just need to get present and be aware, and we're going to move beyond the head that's up on top of our stalks and go down to the head that's in our gut, okay? One more quote here. If you're depressed, you're living in the past. If you're anxious, you're living in the future. If you're at peace, you're living in the present. It's a Lao Tzu quote that I really like. I think it's really powerful. And I think in this culture, you know, we think about, hey, can Bernie Sanders get elected? This could happen, right? You know, it could. I've talked to people who are like, well, you know, even if Bernie was elected, it wouldn't work in this country. You know, the kind of Scandinavian idea, or the idea that we could be like Denmark or Switzerland and we could have a socialist kind of a society that shares and cares about each other. We're too paranoid. This culture is paranoid. We can barely make eye contact or friends with the guy at the restaurant, let alone the person across state lines. You know what I mean? And I was like, a patient told me that, and I was like, that is brilliant, actually. Okay, so moving on. I'm still voting for Bernie, just in case you guys have any question about that. So the yin and yang principle. So Chinese medicine, of course, my background, aside from biomedical sciences, is also in traditional Chinese medicine. And the fundamental principle of traditional Chinese medicine is that the universe exists in a duality, in a dualistic form. So basically the shape of consciousness as we know it is duality. What does that mean? It means that everything is in relation to something else, to everything else. And so understanding how those relationships work, how they look, how they interact, that's the piece of Chinese medicine that got me excited about it, that steered me away from biomedical doctoring and moved me into being a practitioner of Chinese medicine. Okay? It's because this principle is fundamental. And it's not an easy one to understand, even though everybody goes, oh yeah, yin yang, yeah, I know what that is. Yeah, it's the circle, the black and the white, and yeah, it's easy, you know? It's really not that easy. It's really amazing how helpful it is in clinical practice to understand yin and yang theory. Okay? And we're going to talk a little bit about this as we go, and I want to kind of get into some more of the Chinese medicine stuff just to kind of give you an idea, and more of an elemental endocrinology as a way to understand how I look at things and how we can bring this global perspective into our bodies, into the microscopic. So balancing yin and yang, and it's important for finding balance. We want to bring balance into the human body. We want to bring balance into nature. We want to bring balance into our minds. So balancing yin and yang, that's the fundamental principle, okay? Hopefully that's just, it is a simple thing, but as you get into the indivisibility of it and down into microscopic places, you're constantly reapplying yin and yang at different levels. And that's where you start to get this intricacy that comes out of it. And there's a lot of nuance in once you start to get deep into applying the theory. So elemental endocrinology, that's my term for relating the organ networks of the body to the five element system, an elemental system that relates to that macroscopic view of nature and how it interrelates and functions, and then applying that into the body and the functional organ networks that make up the human body. Okay, these aren't organs that are defined by discrete organic definition. These are organ networks that are defined by functionality. Okay, so before we dissected the body, we still knew there was a stomach. We still knew there was a spleen. We still knew there were kidneys and lungs. But these were defined by different words used by the early Chinese doctors a couple thousand years ago and even before, understanding that there were functional elements of what made up the human being and what made up our physiology. Five elements, right? Fire, earth, metal, water, wood. You can start anywhere on the circle. There's the circle supports itself. Wood generates fire. Fire generates earth. And you can see there's easy analogies. You know, you see wood burning, right? Wood burns. Wood creates the fire. Fire then creates the earth. As the wood burns down and has left the materials, we're left with ash. We're also left with volcanic fire that then leaves earth behind. Earth gives rise to metal. As the mountains explode upwards with that fire and earth is being formed, the earth peels back and you're left with this metal point, the stone, the mineral, the rock. That's the metal element. The metal element is giving rise to water. You look at the mountaintops, what do? They're covered in clouds. What does the cloud do? It brings water. Where does the water go? It goes down metal waterways that are carved out of rock, that carve the way that water is distributed out to the wood, the growing life that is in the valleys, in the gullies, in the places, that the alluvial soils, the lowlands where all the foods grow. It's all coming from this cycle, and then we're back to wood generating fire again, and it's this beautiful cycle. There's also a cycle that controls itself within here, where you have relationships, where wood controls earth, where earth controls water. You can see where wood's controlling earth on the edges of the shores and around the oceanic tropics. You see coconut palms holding the sand together as the water's being washed away, and so people plant coconuts along their shores to hold the sand together. You can see it on the sides of roads where trees have grabbed a hold of the earth and they're holding the earth so that it doesn't fall apart. You can see that things like metal controlling wood are really obvious, right? There's two main places. Obviously, we think of sawing and cutting and the way that we use metal implements to control the wood, right? We cut it down, we control it, we shape it. But then also, if you think about that mountain peak, that metal, the top of metal, what does it do at the very top when it starts to get very metallic? Wood falls away. You get to the timberline, right? You can't grow wood at the top of a mountain. So 12 organs, same, 12 organs that we think about in our body, but these are principles. You've got the spleen and the stomach, the liver and the gallbladder, the bladder and the kidney, the lung and the large intestine, small intestine and the heart, and then the triple warmer and the pericardium. And all of these are paired organ networks with an internal and an external pairing. So for the earth representation, we have the spleen being the primary organ network. And the spleen is not the spleen that you think of when you think of the spleen as we know it today in modern biomedicine. The spleen is actually a configuration of functional relationships, duodenum function, pancreatic function, probably part of the stomach function, but that's what the spleen really was functionally to the traditional Chinese medical doctor. Okay? And that's the earth element, and that's where we're going to focus a lot of our energy today. Each one of these organs, by the way, the organ networks in the inside of the circle, those are the yin organs. They're yin compared to the yang organs. They're soft, they're solid, they secrete hormones, and they're nourishing to the body. They're part of our endocrine and neuroendocrine systems. Okay? On the outside of the circle are organs that are called the Fu organs, and they're yang organs, and they're hollow, and they excrete things. It's a very simple distinction, but it's very effective for giving you a basic comprehension and understanding of the relationships.
Do you have that copy of that?
Is it not on your... It should be... Didn't show up in there? Definitely. It's right here. Take a picture. Somebody take a picture. We'll forward it around. I can email it to people too. And I can even find the source of it. The idea is, though, that so you have, like, the idea of the lung and the large intestine. That's the metal element. The lungs are at the top of the body, at the top of the chest, the thoracic cavity. They're like the mountains at the top. They distribute water just like in nature. Water is distributed by the clouds at the top of the mountain. Same story. And then that's the yin organ. That's the zong organ. That's the secreting solid organ. And then on the other side of that, its external pair is the large intestine, which is the hollow organ, which is the excretory organ, which also represents the metal element, okay? I don't have time to go into this whole thing for you guys, but it's really beautiful once you understand it, and it just gives you a principle-based understanding that you can then apply to lots of situations. So eight principles is something I'm going to talk about later on, but this is where yin and yang breaks down into eight principles you use in clinical practice. Is something yin or yang? Is it hot or cold? Is it internal or external? Is it excess or deficiency? Okay, we'll hit this again later. Okay. So the Chinese digestive system. So we have the stomach. We have the spleen. Like I said, the pancreas and duodenum. We've got the small intestine. We've got the large intestine. And then the liver and the gallbladder. Okay? And that's really how the Chinese saw it, functionally. Okay? They didn't dissect this thing to find out. They actually discovered that these were the relationships that were happening in the body, the way we processed food through our networks from one end of the tube to the other end of the tube. Okay? So what's interesting about this is that digestion for a Taoist doctor wasn't just about digesting food. It was about digesting life. So you have all these simple phrases, right? I just can't stomach it. I got a knot in my stomach. You know? These are people really having a feeling, having a sensing something, having an emotional experience. But it's not happening here. You're thinking about it here. You're processing your emotional experience and being like, what is that? That's interesting. Gosh, I wonder if that's related to my mom. But that's not the experience. The experience is happening in the gut. In life, it seems that the most rewarding lessons are often a little hard to digest. How do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. So we get down to digestion, and we start talking about emotional digestion. We need to understand that there's different emotional experiences that have to be digested. And as we look, the coolest thing about the Chinese system of digestion is that you can just go ahead and just apply it straight across from digesting food, as you would take in your bite of food, bring it into the stomach fire then would burn up the food. It would be like the compost getting hot when it's a good compost. It's really hot in the middle. It's breaking things down into smaller pieces. Then that's moving along into the spleen in Chinese medicine, where you're going into this, well, we're going to break it down into smaller bits. We're going to transform the nutrients and transport them around the body, get them into the bloodstream once it's small enough. Then we've got the small intestine, which is going to separate out the clear from the turbid, really start to refine what is this about this experience that I need to keep with me, that I want to take with me, I want to integrate, and what do I want to let go of, and pass it on to the large intestine, who then looks at it and goes, okay, I'm done with this. I'm just going to get the last little bits out of it, and then I'm going to package it up nicely, and I'm going to drop it back into the earth for somebody else to have, like some other animals to feed on, right? But really, this is what's happening in our emotional process. Your mom dies. Okay? I mean, for me, it hasn't happened to me yet, but I've watched my friends go through it. The first thing that happens is like, oh my God, you talk about feeling it in your gut, right? Just the sensation. And then you've got this huge emotional piece. Giant. How do you digest that? You don't just eat it and then, oh, I'm going to eat it and then poop it out. I'm good. Not happening. You're going to get it into your body. You're going to start working on that, and it's going to go through all these layers of you slowly denaturing it into small enough pieces that you can actually start to assimilate bits of that experience and understand what it means for you and make it a part of you and move on and then package up the parts of it that you don't want to keep with you, you want to let go of, and let those go. Let that be the husk that you return. And if that digestion is working perfectly, if your emotional digestion is working perfectly, you can move through incredible emotional trauma in a very graceful way. And if your digestive experience and system isn't working very well, both on a physical and especially on an emotional level, you're going to have a hard time with emotional stuff, emotional traumas in life, okay? This metaphor, this metaphorical way of seeing things to me has become a principal part of how I see my patients in my practice. It's not just digesting food. It's digesting life, okay? Oh, I'll just say something with the liver gallbladder too, just because they're organs of digestion and they have huge impact on our emotional experience. The liver metabolizes everything that gets into the bloodstream. Everything's got to go through the liver. And everything that goes through the spleen and stomach and gets small enough to get in the bloodstream, it's all going to go up through the mesenteric venous system, which is all going to go into the hepatic portal vein, which is all going to go through the liver. It's going to move through the acinar networks, and it's going to get worked on. It's going to get broken down. It's going to get changed. It's going to get metabolized. Phase 1, phase 2, liver detox, right? That process is an emotional process too. And when you are emotionally unable to process what it is that happened to you, it gets stuck. Those metabolic pathways get blocked. They don't work. That backup leads into every aspect of your body, not just the other emotional parts of your body you're trying to deal with, but your physical digestion, irritable bowel syndrome. So in Chinese medicine, we already knew a lot of things. So what we already knew it because now we forgot it and we don't even know it anymore. And each one of those organs I described has a spirit, a part of your spirit housed in it. And the only one I'm going to talk about here is the yi, which is the intelligence. Since the beginning of this system, since its foundation, it was known to the Taoist doctors that your intelligence, your mind, came from your gut. It was housed in the spleen and stomach. That's the digestive tract I talked about. That's the small intestine. That's the pancreas. That's your stomach. Those are the places where major digestion is taking place, where you're just, like I said, you're having this experience of processing life. These are the other spirits you can see. The liver, I'm just going to mention because it's the place where our undying soul lives. It's the place that we go when we dream. It's the part of us that stays conscious when we aren't present. When our mind is asleep, there's part of us that lives on. That's the hun that's in the liver. The liver is a very important piece of this digestive experience. So I want to bring up a concept. Two words, macro ecological and micro rational. Okay? The macro ecological perspective looks at patterns, looks at principles, like my first introduction to this course. It looks at interconnectedness and the whole of things and sees how things interrelate. Micro rational reduces life into microscopic parts. It looks at particles and mechanisms and interactions. Okay? There's a big difference between these two places, these two ways of perceiving the world, but they're both valuable. It's just that right now, one of them keeps saying that none of the other ones matter. And I'm in a different camp. I think they both matter. And I think the top one, the macroecological, is more important. So let's go right into the microrational. Okay? This is a look at the small intestine. Just a little close-up. See the different layers of tissue from the outer serosal layer, the visceral peritoneum. You go down into the muscle layers, right? And you can see inside the muscle layers, you see the nerve plexuses inside there. You go below that and you get into the submucosal layer where you've got glands, you've got blood vessels, you've got more nerves running there. You've got more plexuses. You go down deeper, there's the internal, another muscular layer. And then you're into the mucosal layer, which is where we're going to spend most of our time here talking, which includes that inner layer there, which also includes these ducts, there's immune cells, there's nerves, there's a simple squamous epithelial lining, the luminal cells of the intestine, a single layer that interacts with the external environment. That's the environment that we brought in, right? It's our soil. That's where the key to this whole thing is going to happen. Just to take a little closer look here, dropping in further, this is where we get closer. You see, those are the villi. Those are like our roots. And on those roots, there are microvilli, which are even smaller, that give us more surface area and allow us to, you know, contact more and more of our soil. More room for microbiomes and everything else to live. You can see here that the layers are separated differently, right? This is a different kind of cross-section where you're going from the outer, that visceral outer layer, the serosa, then you're going into that muscularis, the external muscle, and inside there you'll see the myenteric plexuses. These plexuses are groups of nerves that all link together that are related to how the muscles function inside this GI tract, but they're linked directly to the entire nervous system, so they have much bigger function than that. Then we've got that inner layer, the submucosa, which is, like I said, we're going to spend a lot of time, and then in the mucosa itself, but in the submucosa is another layer of plexuses, the submucosal plexuses, and those are also places where a lot of neurological activity is happening. Inside this, you've got lymph ducts, you know, the same thing we saw before, the same structures, blood vessels, lymph nodes, and white blood cells, immunological activity. This is just a look at what's happening at this little tiny part of our body that is so infinitely complex. And when we go into this part and we talk about the little stuff, I want to maintain the perspective of the big stuff. Keep applying the principles and the patterns as we drop our perspective down into smaller and smaller microscopic views. You know what I mean by that? If you're looking at a red blood cell, what if you still applied yin and yang to the different parts of the blood cell? What if we could apply principles that I'm talking about in the macroscopic world and maintain them and see how are those relationships played out at the microscopic? And that's what I want to just try to convey. Let's try to do both at the same time. So when we look at digestion from the biomedical sense, we know that we are what we eat, digest, absorb, and assimilate. All that together, right? Food comes in, before it comes in, you think about food and you start already salivating, right? We know that. There's a cerebral digestion that's occurring. You take in food into your mouth, you chew it up, you've got mechanical process of breaking that food down into smaller bits, you swallow it down through the esophagus, it moves through peristaltic action, there's a stretch on the esophagus that stimulates nerves, induces hormonal changes that then relate to the stomach and to the downward, further along digestive organs. The stomach then starts to secrete hydrochloric acid, pepsin, the gastric juices, the mucus that's going to make up the stomach lining. All that process starts to get going. The rugae start contracting. The food gets into the stomach. It starts to get rotted and ripened, right? It starts to go into its composting. It's being denatured, the bigger pieces into smaller and smaller pieces. That's stimulating the opening of the lower pylorus, the lower sphincter of the stomach, to allow those contents to move into the small intestine, which is then stimulating the pancreas to start releasing pancreatic enzymes, to start breaking things down further, which is also stimulating the gallbladder to start releasing bile, to start working on the fats. This is the big stuff, right? And I'll get back to liver, gallbladder. You know, your mom dies, that idea. How do you digest that? You need bile. We got to start emulsifying that fatty, long, big thing into smaller bits. That's the concentrated action of the liver through the gallbladder to do that work of digesting those fats. That's happening there. There's a bicarbonate buffer that's being created to stop that huge acidity from the hydrochloric acid that's so acidic from the stomach. That's happening in the small intestine. Then you've got all this assimilation that starts happening. You've got the duodenal enzymes, the pancreatic enzymes. They're all working together. Then you're moving things down through the small intestine, the duodenum, to the jejunum, to the ileum, where you're pulling in things like iron and B12 and vitamin K, so many important nutrients. Then you're getting to the ileocecal valve, which is the valve that's literally a valve that opens and closes on neurological and endocrine control to allow the contents of the small intestine, stuff you're still working on, to go into the large intestine where it can be packaged up for waste. And that's, once that area is passed, you're into that last section, the colon, which then has its, you know, it's three different main parts. Throughout the whole thing, most of it is being done the same thing. You're packaging the material, you're removing some water, extracting a few minerals, and getting ready to let go of what you're done with. Okay? That's the biomedical side of things. Now, that system looks like it works great, right? It's so great. We're so poised to live in this world and to do this life thing, eat food, digest emotional experience and move on and be healthy, right? But we have a few problems. We've got an altered food supply. We've got a toxic environment. We're all stressed out and worried and, you know, we're overweight. We talked about being paranoid about other people, about what's going to happen to us. We're not sleeping well. We don't allow ourselves to sleep. We don't take time. You're supposed to have three jobs, right, to make this country go. We got to make progress, guys. Lack of exercise. Well, when you're sitting at the darn desk, you know, doing your computer work, making sure the company survives, so you're not surviving. So these are our things that we're fighting against, the things that are inhibiting this digestive system from working as effectively as it could. When I talk about altered food supply, what am I talking about? Modern technological agribusiness, right? It's not good for the gut. It's really good for the pocketbook. It's really good for the business model. But you've got everything from the seeds that are now, you know, we don't have good seed stocks. Everything's being, you know, hybridized, and we get down to genetic modified foods and them, you know, interbreeding with all of our seed stocks. We don't have heritage seeds anymore. We don't have wild strains, wild varieties of things that are hardy and resistant to environmental conditions that would make them stronger and more, you know, nutrient dense for us in the first place. We've got harvest and storage issues. We've got stuff going on the shelf, stuff going into refrigerators. We've got stuff going onto trucks. We've got things in bags and tins and packages. We run it through processing mills. We turn it into all kinds of other things. We cook it. We heat it. We combine it with chemicals to turn it into other things. I mean, this is what we're eating. This is not food. Where's the dirt in all that? So then we've got the toxic environment. And I mean, I just put the list. I mean, I just kind of threw out there what was kind of came to mind quick, but there's so much. I mean, we're living in a chemical soup, you guys, a chemical soup of hundreds of thousands of chemicals that we've never encountered before, ever. And we're living in it, you know, and it's really scary. You know, the solvents, the pesticides, herbicides, fungicides, you know, the vector control team. Now they're adding Zika virus control to the vector control for mosquitoes, specially modified drugs that funded by Monsanto, coming from Japan, under the name of something, Simviro or something. You know, like, what is going on? And so how do we deal with this stuff in our bodies? We don't know. And the strange thing is that we are so diverse and so unique, you can't predict what we're going to do, how we're going to do. One person might do great with that chemical. You might take DDT and just bust it right out, no problem. Broke it down, done. The next guy, I have no idea what to do this stuff. Man, boom, cancer, dead. We don't know. So let's start talking about the bugs. This is my favorite part. So the microbiome, right? So if we take our intestinal surface area and spread it out, it's 200 square meters, give or take a lot for different sized people, but it's the size of a tennis court. It's a big surface area to be interfacing with microbes. We're talking about a lot of microbes here. 100 trillion microorganisms living in our bodies. That includes the skin, the mouth, that includes your eyes, that includes inside your gut, that includes all over your body, everywhere. 100 trillion microbes. What's really fascinating about that to me is that we've estimated that there are about 10 trillion human cells. So that's 10 to 1. So what is a human being? What is a human? Well, it's 10 parts bugs and 1 part human. That's no joke, you guys. That's serious. That's like, okay, that's cool. I'm really glad that people are seeing that that's the truth, because it makes the ecological perspective much more important. Because when it comes down to it, we're really farmers and shepherds, guys, for these bodies, which are not our own human cells that just have these weird infections that we're kind of trying to fight with. No, that's not it. We are actually a collection, a conglomeration of incredible, rich, diverse realm of microorganisms that together allow us to be alive. Without them, we don't exist. We aren't human beings without these bugs, without the microbiota. Okay? And so tending them, we're farming because we want to make sure that all these, the plant life in our body is strong. We're working with yeasts and fungi. We want to shepherd these things. We're like shepherds. We need to make sure that our flora, our fauna, our flock is happy, strong, provides us, sustains us, gives us nutrition, takes care of us, protects us. We need a strong flock. So another thing about the genome of the microbiota in our bodies is that it encodes 100 times more genes than the human genome. Okay? So the Human Genome Project is pretty cool. But that's 1/100th of the genome of the bugs that live inside of our bodies. Okay? So the microbiome versus microbiota, I just want to clarify because I'm going to use the terms in this talk, and microbiota is the term we're going to use most of the time. People always say, oh, it's microbiome, it's microbiome. Well, yeah, it is, but the microbiome is the genetic information. It's the pool of genes that make up our microbiota. So when we talk about the microbiome, we're really talking about the genes. We're talking about the microbiota, we're talking about the microbes themselves. Okay? So we're going to talk about microbiota. So what makes the microbiota in our bodies special? Well, it's virtually infinitely diverse. It spans the tree of life, meaning all the different types of life forms defined from our kingdoms, our phyla, they're all represented in our bodies. What is it to characterize a healthy microbiome then? You know, because the microrational approach would say, well, we're just going to go in and we're just going to start taking samples from healthy people. We're going to identify all the bugs that are present, and we're going to say this is the spectrum of bugs that a healthy person should have. Well, it doesn't work. We're all different. What's a healthy microbiome? What's a healthy microbiota for a person? It's a microbiota that keeps you healthy mentally, emotionally, and physically. And it's one that's resilient to changes. So when it gets hit with that toxic burden, when it gets hit with that altered food supply, it recovers quickly. When it gets the DDT poisoning, when it gets the new X-Vitamin, whatever the new drug is, the new compound, the new pesticide, the new paint, the new floorboards, the new exhaust, whatever it is, that biota, if it gets damaged and changed, when the exposure goes away, that biota comes back into where it was before. Harmony, balance. And what is it characterized by? Diversity. It's diverse. There's no one type of bug that's really good for us. There's no 5 types of bug that's really good for us. We have identified genuses of bugs that are generally really beneficial for us, for sure. And we should have lots of those. But we're going to need to have some of all of it together, all of them, because they work in symbionts. They work together, talking to each other, communicating with each other, fighting with each other, arguing with each other, making chemicals against each other, all of it. That's what they do in order to set up an ecosystem that's perfect for us. So I just want to make sure that's really clear. What's important about the microbiota is not what bugs are there. It's, are all the bugs working together in a way that makes you healthy? And is it diverse? And is it resilient? All right, so who lives here? Who are we talking about? Well, this recent analysis showed that there were over 35,000 bacterial species in the gut. Well, I saw another one recently that said there's over 40,000 species now identified in the human gut. Of course, that's not going to be in you or me. That's kind of looking across at people across the world and identifying how many different species of bacteria, this is just bacteria, live in the human body. Well, there's over 40,000 now that we've identified. What else lives there? Archaea. You know what archaea are? They're prokaryotes too. They don't have like a fully developed nucleus. They're similar to a bacteria, but they function a little differently. They're kind of a mysterious one. They don't interact with us quite as intimately, but they're the things that we originally found sort of around really like hot spots under the ocean, you know, where they'd be like, oh, the temperature here is, you know, 1,000 degrees. Archaea would live right at that interface right there. They have incredible adaptive capacity. They live in our gut. Fungi and yeast, especially the candida species, which there's many species. These are very important denizens of our gut. The virome, all the viruses, and the protozoans, those small microorganisms that we think of as parasites, and they are. And the helminths, the worms, right? All the worms that we think of. We know people often think of worms when they think of parasites. So there are a couple different ways to look at our microbes. There's a group of them that are called commensal. Commensal microbes are microbes that are common to eating at the same table as us. So common and mensa, common table. They're bugs that come and eat at the common table with us. They're not really doing much for us. They're not feeding us, but we're sitting down to eat dinner together. We brought our lunches, and we're going to do it together. Okay? Mutual or symbiotic organisms are organisms that benefit each other. So some bugs are mutualistic. That means that they provide us with something, whether it's protection, whether it's with nutrients, whether it's certain metabolites that stimulate our neurotransmitters. And then they're also getting something back from us because we're providing them with protection. We're providing them with environment. We're providing them with food. Commensal bugs, they're really just, they're interacting with the other bugs and they're kind of like part of the crosstalk communication between the network, but they're not giving us directly anything that we can identify. They're part of the, you know, that's why I said it's hard to define, because these lines get pretty hard to, you know, really qualify or quantify. Like, how do you really, is that bug really not helping us? Does it help us in some ways? Does it indirectly help us? So the other kind of organism is a parasitic organism. And this is where one organism is harmed while the other benefits. Okay? And there's a little bit more to the story we're going to see, because it's not just harm. Sometimes those parasitic relationships are very important. So let's talk about bacteria. Very ancient form of life. 40 million bacterial cells in a gram of soil. 1 million bacterial cells in 1 milliliter of fresh water. These are prokaryotes that have immense functions inside of our bodies. Okay? They're going to help us control pH, which in the GI tract is essential for proper functioning, for proper digestion. A lot of these enzymes depend on a balanced pH inside the colon, inside the small intestine. Digestion of proteins and carbohydrates, a lot of these bigger molecules are hard for us to break down. And so we use the interrelationship with the microbes to help us be able to absorb them, make them into smaller pieces for us. They metabolize these things for us. They manufacture vitamins and essential fatty acids for us, get them ready for absorption, increase our and improve our immune function. They break down other bacterial toxins from bacteria that are actually dysbiotic. If another kind of bacteria is overgrowing in us, something like Clostridium or something, like C. diff, if that's out of control, bacteria that we have in our guts will help to control that infection by releasing bactericidins, bacteriocins, compounds that kill off other bacteria to control them. And then conversion of flavonoids into anti-tumor and anti-inflammatory compounds. There's a lot of good research coming out in how flavonoids actually work by interacting with the gut biota to then become other compounds that protect us even further. So some of the common bacteria in the gut, you know, we have the lactobacillus, bifidobacterium, the clostridium, even though that one gets out of control, clostridium species are still essential for us. Bacteroides fragilis, the enterococci, and some strains of E. coli are actually important for our GI tract too. Lactobacilli have a lot of antifungal activities, antimicrobial. They do these things, lactosidin, lactobacillin. These are all antimicrobial agents that kill off funguses, kill off bacteria, kill off other invading organisms to help us. But really, they're just trying to help them. But it's a symbiotic relationship, so they're helping themselves be stable. And in that process, we want them to be stable because we benefit from them. And then they kick out the bad guys so that they're not going to be taking away from us. So the human virome, this is a really interesting thing because the viruses are so small, right? They're really hard for us to study. They don't function like most other living organisms. And we don't know a whole lot about them other than that we know that they really do mess with DNA. We know that because we see them in now being a big part of cancer progression. We know that squamous cell carcinomas are driven by viral infections, whether they're in the cervix or in the head, neck, and throat. We know that several other cancers, even the brain cancers now, gliomas, glioblastomas, have a cytomegalovirus element to them being driven by viral changes where the virus is injecting its RNA into the cell and changing the function of the nucleus and affecting DNA replication, leading to mutations that then are propagated along the cell lines to create offspring that are monoclonal cells, that are cancer cells. So we know that's happening, but what they're doing at the level of our microbiota is they're actually acting as bacteriophages. They're actually doing this where they come to the bacterial cell wall and they inject their material into the bacteria. They replicate themselves. They basically take over the DNA copy machine, and the DNA copy machine starts making their own DNA. It starts pumping out new viruses for them, and then they grow and they explode out of that bacteria and go to the next one. But interestingly enough, is the bacteria fighting them off and trying to compete with them, and what's being done in the process is bacteria are getting this kind of longitudinal evolution by the genetic influence of the viruses. And they're doing this in our body too. They're pushing evolution. They're changing our DNA. They're causing mutations that at the bacterial level are leading to new variants, some of them being very strong and resilient and powerful and could be very powerful for us too. So the viruses are playing a really important role here on some level. We just don't know exactly what that is. We know that there's a big part of genetic diversity happening through their existence. And rotavirus infections, that's the guy on the left there, it's the most common cause of pediatric diarrhea worldwide. So fungi, we're going to see here that we have a lot of mutualistic relationships between fungi and the human body. Really interesting. We think about fungi in a lot of different ways. I talked about mycorrhizae and the importance of the fungal network in the propagation of wood, plant life. It's the same thing for us. They play a very important role, getting things ready for us in the gut, having an interrelationship with the other microbes. Candida, that's the number one present microbe in our bodies. Malassezia and Saccharomyces, they're all really present in the healthy population. So these are fungi that are present in our bodies and should be. They should be there. We need them. Trans-kingdom interactions. So how the fungi interact with the bacteria, who are interacting with the viruses, who are interacting with the archaea, all that interacts with the protozoans and the helminths, the worms that are coming through. All of that is super critical and important. And it's about mutual control, where the interplay of the different organisms is what gives us that resilience in our healthy microbiota, which makes us healthy people. So just kind of a little bit more that understanding that the microbiota are super essential for us. They're not just occupying space. They're essential for nutrient metabolism, protecting us from opportunistic infections, helping us develop our immune system. And we'll find that in the young person, in the developing human, it's very important. Very important, neurologically, immunologically, and in the digestive system, to have a good microbiota. Yes, ma'am? Yeah. I'm going to hit Saccharomyces a little down the road. Yeah. Yep. Yes, I did have it on there. Thank you. Yep. Yes, and it is there with cholera for a reason. So let me, I'll hit that one a little later. There's a whole Saccharomyces slide. So the gut microbiota appears to influence the host at nearly every level and in every organ system, highlighting our interdependence and coevolution. So what's being uncovered in the micro-rational mind now is that, God, we need the bugs, man. We have to have them. We have to have this microbiota. And it's just so fascinating to see it uncovering, coming to light. So I want to talk about the worms and the protozoans, okay? Some of these are common. Some of the protozoans are common in healthy people, and they should be probably. They've got a lot of variability. One of the main ones we see, and this is if you do stool sampling, you see this a lot, blastocystis hominis. It can get out of control too. It's more kind of frequently encountered in cultures that are less affluent, that have less of a very cleanly type of antibiotic controlled and septic type of approach. They're not really doing the germ theory approach so much. Those cultures have more protozoans, more helminths present in them, and they're more of a common part of the digestive tract. Up here, we've kind of eliminated these creatures for the most part, not for good only reasons. Probably it's not so good for us. The worms, they have a significant role to play in our evolutionary history, and they've been a big part of it. In Chinese medicine, there's something called Gu syndrome, and Gu was the word kind of for worm. And it was really kind of like, it represented this entrenched parasitism that existed in the medical field. They would see this in people. People would get this really extreme nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, you know, the kind of this whole process we see people go through, gas and, you know, maybe sulfur smelling, that kind of thing. And they would say, okay, this is goo. And imagine that they dug around into, you know, their feces and found there were worms there, literally. And they knew that. They actually had different herbs that would be used to try to, you know, stop the, if it was a tapeworm, for example, they had one herb that would specifically calm the tapeworm down, stop it from moving, get it stuck so it couldn't get away, and then they would take a second herb in there that would actually go in there and kill that worm and just, like, you know, knock it out. So, and you could actually create a process whereby you knock the worms out, you kick them out of the body, they have to release as from their adherence onto the intestinal walls. That's the way that they approached it. And it's, you know, so we've had this idea of the worms for a very, very long time, you know, way back. And it wasn't only worms. They would apply that goo idea to a parasitic infection of any kind. And again, parasitic infections are not just, you know, protozoans and helminths. It can be other organisms that have gotten so dysbiotic that they're just dominating the interrelationships inside the microbiota, and they're absorbing too much of the nutrients or taking away from us. And it becomes parasitic because they're evolving and they've become too big of a part of our microbiota and our intestinal lumen. So one thing about worms that's really fascinating is that they regulate our immune response, right? So a quarter of the world's population infected with helminths cause significant morbidity, like we talked about, but rarely cause death. So back to that idea, you know, being aware of the host, even if you're not aware of it consciously, the things that you do, there's changes that alert you to the fact that you need to move on, you need to calm down, stop growing uncontrollably, you're in relationship. What's really interesting is that in these lower income societies where there's a higher incidence of these diarrheal diseases, a higher incidence of parasitic infections, what there's a lower incidence of is autoimmunity, allergies, asthma. It's a big distinction, because even in these epidemiological studies, you can see that in the new countries that have more of this septic approach, more of this germ theory, we've kind of eradicated most of the worms and the protozoans, we're suffering from huge rates of autoimmunity, right? Huge rates of asthma and allergies. So what was starting to happen is that people started to see that there was a connection in recent years, and there's been some studies that actually looked at giving people worm infections to treat their autoimmune disease. And there were some cool studies on rheumatoid arthritis, actually helping people cure their arthritis by giving them infections with helminths, giving them a worm infection. And it works because the worms have a role to play in us, just like everything else in nature does. We've grown up with them. They're part of us. We don't want to just annihilate them and get rid of them. We want to help them find their place. But to me, it gets back to the idea that, you know, I'm not into vaccines for most things. I want people to be able to get sick and get well. I'm not into antibiotics unless they're absolutely necessary. I want people to get sick and get well. And the idea of getting sick is that your body learns every time. And when we get a worm infection, your body learns a lot. It gets informed. And there's a relationship between the Th2 type responses in the helminths that get dampened by their presence. And this is the type of response that leads to the antigenic antibody autoimmunity that leads to identifying your own self as non-self and then making antibodies towards your own tissue. And the fact that you can reverse that by actually, you know, giving somebody infection with a helminth is just totally fascinating to me. And I think it's really something we need to consider. Again, annihilating the bugs doesn't really work, but strengthening their interrelationships in our body, making our soil better, a better place for us as farmers and shepherds, we can make a biota that's perfectly resistant, where we get sick only for little bits of time. We recover really quickly. And each time we do, we learn more and we get better. Okay. Everybody doing okay? I'm really fascinated by this stuff. I keep hitting some button on here, though, and I don't know which one, and then it like stops doing what it's supposed to do. Oh, wait, it's supposed to be over here? Let's see. Yeah. Okay. This is the gut-activated lymph tissue, right? This is the gut immune system. So what is the gut immune system doing? We saw in those pictures earlier, right, that there's lymph nodes, there are lymph cells functioning right at the lumen of the small intestine. We know that the immune system is very active there. What's it doing? Well, it's got a difficult job, okay? It's got to do two things at once. It's got to tolerate the overlying microbiota so that all the bugs that need to be there can be there and can be present in just the right amount so that they're providing us with all the things that we talked about them providing us with. You know, defense from other infections, giving us nutrients, making metabolites, all the things they're doing, informing our immune system. We need them there. But we also have to control them, because if we let them go, they'll just do their own thing. They'll just keep on growing until they get out of control. And we need to be this intervening force, our immune system, to keep them at the perfect relationship between just enough and too much. So the physical separation is a big part of it, and of the kind of what the gut immune system has to do, because we need to keep the bugs sort of separate from our luminal cells, the cells that line our intestines. We don't want to have the bugs right there interfacing, because they're going to start doing things. They're going to kind of find ways in, and they get into our bloodstream, and they can move deeper. We don't want that. We want to keep them out on the outer layers of the mucus layer. We'll see some good images of this later on. We want to keep them just at the right place where they're able to interact with the soil and do all the preparation of that soil for us that they need to be doing, so we can absorb it and pull it in, and it can affect us in many ways. Okay? So they actually, the immune system has to modify the microbes sometimes, actually interact with them, and actually change the way that they stimulate other immune cells. And what we found is that the gut immune system, actually, the same cell lines that look the same on tissue, they're actually different. The way that they function in the gut is different than they function in other parts of the body because of this relationship with the microbiota. They have to be so careful and such tenders and farmers and shepherds that we're talking about inside the lumen. They need to keep things really balanced. They function differently. They're like their own specialized force, are the immune cells in the gut, the GALT. We're going to talk about SIGA, which is the secretory immunoglobulin A. It's the biggest amount of immunoglobulin that we really make in the whole body, and it covers the entire luminal space inside the intestine. It covers the mucosal layer, and it's there to protect us. It's there to interact with the microbes to make sure that we're in harmony. Without it, we really have a hard time controlling the microbiota. Things would get out of control. So SIGA is a very important part of our immune system and a part of the microbiota itself. A little bit more on secretory IgA. So it's the first line of defense for the GI mucosa. It binds to antigenic epitopes on the invading microorganism, limiting their mobility and adhesion to the epithelium. So it's one thing that the bugs do is they want to adhere, they want to set up camp in our bodies. And in order to do that, they have to bypass our system, or our system has to say, okay, it's cool, we're going to let you camp here. And that's where the immune system gets involved. That's where the IgA is present as an immunoglobulin that can be kind of induced to stick onto the bugs to prevent them from attaching to the epithelium, that can be used as an antibody towards the bugs. And as the immune system changes the relationships, what's happening, it can induce the IgA to get more active. It can be more, you know, it can stick to a bug more. It can be more protective and inhibit them from sticking onto our bodies. This is kind of how the IgA is important. And we're going to see that later on, too, as we get into treatment type of ideas, that the IgA is a big place we want to look, and we want to help people. And there's a lot of things we can do to support secretory IgA. We want it to be in a normal level. If it's really high in a person, we know they're having a big upregulated immune response. That's, you know, the things are going crazy in there, and there's a lot of immunoglobulin present in the gut. If there's not enough of it, then we know that there's also a problem. There's not enough immune control happening, and there could be an overproliferation of microbiota that's leading to this low immunoglobulin production. So probably it's a low immune function at that level. L-glutamine is the required nutrient for SIGA. So we have to have glutamine.
Okay.
We're going to talk about glutamine down the road, too. We'll get down to that as we get into therapies. So I put here, microbes directing the show. So I want to start talking a little bit more about the microbes and their interaction with our bodies, because it's the dynamic interplay that fascinates me the most. So preserving the homeostasis at the intestinal mucosa should be in the gut microbiota's best interest, as it provides a convenient long-term habitat. So again, the bugs are here, they want it to be good for them. They want it to keep being good for them. They want to make it right. So they're working to try and make this place stable. They want it to be homeostatic. They don't want it to be a place that tidal waves are coming through, that heat waves are coming through, that huge changes are coming through, wiping out their populations. They're working to try and, you know, maintain a stable environment. They also maintain a physical barrier. They compete against each other. This idea of occupation of attachment sites, this is really interesting. We're going to see how that works. These bugs have to attach themselves to our tissue in order to set up their microcolonies. And in order to do that, they've got to work with the immune system directly, and they've got to compete with the other organisms to find these sources. These bugs, when they're competing with each other, they consume each other's nutrient sources. So that's part of their maintaining homeostasis, is that they're sort of sharing the resources that are available. And they secrete antimicrobial substances to stabilize their own environment, to keep other bugs from taking over. I think that we've got that pretty clear, right? So the host, us, we can actually stimulate the bugs to make more compounds. And the interplay between our immune system, our nervous system, and the microbiota is something that we're just scratching the surface on as far as the depth of its interrelationship. It's very, very interwoven. That's why when I said there's 100 trillion of these microbes in our bodies, understand that these microbes are directing the show. They are. They are little individuals. Just like the cells in our body are making decisions, they're all acting individually. And their individual action creates higher holonics. It creates other levels of organization that they might not even be conscious of. Just like we in this room are creating another layer of organization, this camp, this city, this country, the human population, these are holonics. We look down, a cell, a group of cells in a tissue. A tissue is part of an organ. An organ is a part of an organ system. Organ systems as part of an organism. Organisms as part of a society, or as part of a city, as a village. Organisms as part of a colony. And colonies as part of a population. Populations as part of a earth, inhabitants. You know, these are holonic levels. Then you have the solar system. You've got the galaxy. So the idea of holons is really important to me. And I think that each individual acting at their own holon, just by doing that, creates the next level. They create another level of organization. Okay? This seems pretty obvious. A strong association has now been illustrated between the intestinal microbiota and colorectal cancer. Well, yeah. If things aren't going well down there, we'll show up with problems, cancer being one of the big ones. And when the microbes are affected by all the different things we discussed, the altered food supply, the toxic environment, then it's not just the compounds that damaged our body, it's the compounds that damaged the microbiota that then damage our ability to live in homeostasis. So this is cool. This is from David Perlmutter. And he was just describing kind of what's really startling about the influence of the microbiota on our minds. And this is where we get to kind of some really fascinating stuff. So we already kind of talked about how they influence all manner of physiology, from the immune system to the metabolism. They affect all these mechanisms involved in Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, MS, brain degenerative disorders. They exert influence over the expression of our 23,000 genes. They regulate expression of the human genome. And what's really fascinating to him is that they found now bacterial DNA actually in the human genome. This just occurred. This isn't even published yet. So the way that it's being woven, the intimate way that these microbes and their minds and their approach, their whole on, is being woven into our minds and our bodies is becoming a place of great discovery for us and a place we can really start to help people in a huge way once we understand this much more deeply. But I want to make sure that you understand that as we get back to the ecological approach, the macro ecological, right, we're farming and tending. If we apply the patterns, we apply the principles, we do the farming, we practice the good agriculture, we do the permaculture, what happens? We make happy microbes. We make happy flora and fauna. Do we need to identify them as microbes and understand all that? No. Do we like to? Yeah. Is it fascinating? Yeah, it is. And is it great for emergencies to use drugs? Sure. But when we want to keep people healthy, we want to use our concepts of permaculture, of farming, of shepherding. So he just talks about here, you know, our perceptions of the world, moods, hunger, or satiety, even our metabolism are dictated by gut bacteria, which deserve careful stewarding. They don't deserve, for example, to be bombarded by the capricious use of antibiotics whenever we have the sniffles. I like that. So one discovery that came to my mind recently that just, it's just kind of a nice reminder that we don't know everything, because we thought neurology was pretty well mapped out in the 60s, but just recently the Bigfoot of neurology was discovered to be true. Meningeal lymphatics, that there is actually a meningeal network in the brain. Wow! They just discovered that cytomegalovirus lives in the brain. Hey, I thought the brain was septic. There's nothing in there. No, sorry guys. The brain's actually a living integral part of everything that we are, and it's not separate. And we need to keep reminding ourselves that. And this is just so fascinating to me that we actually see that the lymph system is actually interacting with the brain in a very direct way through these meningeal lymphatics. So let's go to the next level here. Enteric nervous system. What is that? The enteric nervous system. Enteric really refers to the gut, because it refers to the GI tract. And the enteric nervous system is this nervous system that exists inside of our intestines, our stomach, our esophagus. It's all the way to the rectum and the anus. It's throughout the entire tube, okay? You can see here, just a little bit of a different view of what we saw earlier, but we have here the Meissner's plexuses, which are here inside this submucosal layer. And then we have the Auerbach plexuses, which are a little bit further out. These are out into the muscularis layer. These plexuses are very complex. There are a lot of them, and they're all interacting and communicating with each other continuously in time. And they're not just communicating about how our poop moves through our tube. They're communicating about all kinds of things, everything, the microbes, our brain, how we think, how we feel, are we hungry, are we not hungry. It's all going through this nervous system called the enteric nervous system. Its study is now called neurogastroenterology. It's a huge new blossoming field of medicine. And research is coming out in reams about it. So there are over 500 billion neurons now described in the enteric nervous system. That's a lot of neurons. It's not as many as there are in the brain. But remember, the brain is the switchboard for all the functioning of all of our organ networks. Our entire neuroendocrine system depends on the brain as a switchboard. This nervous system, which is being referred to as the second brain, I actually think it should be called the first brain. It came before this brain. I think this brain is more of a tool that's been an extension of that first brain, the tube. The tube that existed to bring things in one end and let them out the other, that is networked deeper and deeper into a system that preserves its own existence so that all the things that live inside of it can proliferate and grow forever. So the more elaborate the tools became, meaning our ability to perceive through all of our senses, to think, to make tools, to create social interactions that bring us together, all the things that we've done to elaborate our existence has created incredible diversity for the microbes that live inside of us. So this first enteric nervous system represents what we talked about earlier. If you feel it in your gut, you really feel it, right? Digesting things through the GI tract. This is what's going on, okay? This is really fascinating because it's linked directly to the central nervous system and to the autonomic nervous system. It's completely linked via the vagus nerve and via preganglionic neurons. And people would think, you know, oh yeah, well, it's the brain that controls it all. Nope, it's not. They took rats, they cut off the vagus nerve. Ching! No more connection. Guess what happened? The enteric nervous system just kept on doing its thing. Kept on doing its thing, kept digesting food, kept moving things along, kept doing all of its nervous interaction. It just kept on going. So its function is actually separate from the central nervous system and the autonomic nervous system, which is also very fascinating. Now, separate in the sense that it can act separately, but it's also plugged directly in. So it feeds information back and forth continuously between the central nervous system and what's happening inside the gut. One of the other fascinating things about the enteric nervous system, it uses more than 30 known neurotransmitters. A lot of these will be familiar to you as we get closer to them. Here's just a little example. You can kind of see some of the nerves there extending up to the spinal cord and up through the vagus nerve. 90% of the signals that are being generated, okay, passing along in the vagus nerve, 90% of them are coming from the enteric nervous system, going up to the brain. Not going from the brain down to the gut. Only 10%. Okay? So one of the things that happens is, you know, obviously the gut reactions type of thing. You've got the vagus nerve and its connection with things like nausea, vomiting. You've also got the other type of effects like the gut reactions where peristalsis is being generated by the nervous system there to create diarrhea, to create, you know, expulsion of toxins, getting rid of microbes or getting rid of parasites. These things are being controlled by the enteric nervous system for sure. That's probably its primary control, is to regulate the tube and make sure that things are moving smoothly and that, you know, if things need to get expelled and get out of it, then it can create muscular contraction. It's also regulating the constant peristaltic contraction, the constant movement of foods through the system, the movement of the soil along that tract from end to end. That's its part of its control. This slide right here has a couple of really interesting points. Up here in the brain, you can see that you have this 85 billion neurons in the brain, and here you have 500 million neurons in the second brain. So not nearly as many neurons, but remember, the brain is incredibly complex. Yes? That's, you know what, that's because the printing, that's not on me, I'm sorry. I'm not sure why they didn't get those printed. I mean, some of them showed up, right? I mean, I can see there's a number of them on there.
Anything is attached to where you have text, anything on it.
So if it's just a picture, it shows up? And if it's a text and a picture, it doesn't?
That's right.
Wonder why that is. So, you know who needs to know about this is the producers of the conference, so that we can get our technologies linked up so we can get those on there. That kind of really sucks for you guys. Maybe I can have them print out another copy. Maybe we can see if we can figure out what that glitch is and see if we can get you guys copies if you want them for down the road.
Do you have a website? Can you post it there?
I could post it. I will post it.
Yeah.
Hopefully I'll post the talk to go right along with it.
We just copied.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Thanks for bringing that up for me. I really appreciate it. I did not know that. Yeah. Yeah. Yep. You're looking down here?
No, up right there. So just on the upper right.
Right here?
Up more, right here. What does that show?
That's the large intestine. It's just representing a nerve from the large intestine coming back up through the ganglionic chain up here, connecting directly to the spine. Sorry, this isn't exactly clear, is it? A couple of things that we see here are that the brain uses over 100 neurotransmitters. The second brain here uses 40 neurotransmitters. We're just uncovering this as we go. 50% of all of our dopamine comes from the second brain. 95% of all of our serotonin comes from the second brain. Only 5% of the serotonin we use comes from our brain, and only 50% of our dopamine comes from our brain. We're going to get more into that. And we have a blood-brain barrier, and we have a blood-brain barrier. We're going to talk about both of those and how important they are. So let's talk about the gut-brain axis, right? That was in the title of the talk. What is the gut-brain axis? Well, the gut-brain axis is this link between the brain and the first brain. So it's a really interesting and fascinating interwoven system. You can see here from this diagram that you have the brain here. You've got, this is kind of the vagal system where the vagus nerve is relaying information back and forth. You have the different components. You have immune cells functioning here. You have epithelial cells. This is the single layer of epithelium that exists along the lumen of the entire digestive tract. You have these cells here, enterochromaffin cells, which are the cells that literally produce our serotonin. You have these smooth muscle cells and interstitial cells that are connected to the way that the muscles move inside the gut. And you have the enteric neurons, which signal both locally and then distally up to the brain. Okay? Just a little example of the different things that happen here, you know, the changing perturbations, microbial signals. The microbes are inside of here making changes that are affecting all of these structures that are affecting the brain. It's a constant bidirectional communication network. Signaling is going on back and forth, okay? And the brain is modulating these cells and these cells and these cells and these to help the interface. So we're actually interacting with the way that these cells interact with the microbiota and vice versa. So we're linking the emotional and cognitive centers of the brain with the peripheral intestinal functions. So local, like we said, local control, peripheral functions, and then brain center. Remember what I said earlier about the digesting the life experience and that whole thing? I just can't believe how cool it is that gastroenteroenterology, or neurogastroenterology, is going to say the same thing that the Taoist teachers of mine said 2,000 years ago. Couldn't we just start at that point? Like, and just skip all the stuff in between? So some gut-brain axis exchanges that are important. So from the gut microbiota to the brain, this is so from the gut going up, the production and expression of neurotransmitters, like I said, serotonin, dopamine, GABA, neurotrophic factor for the brain, a number of other, like we said, one of those slides that said 40 neurotransmitters, the protection of the intestinal barrier and tight junction integrity. This is really important. This is like the blood-brain barrier of the second brain, okay? And the biota need to be there to make it work. Modulation of the enteric sensory afferents. So what's going up to the brain coming from the enteric nervous system? Bacterial metabolites. The metabolites, like things like tryptophan, things like 5-HTP that then become serotonin. These things. These are things that the gut microbiota are producing that are then influencing the brain. And then the immune system. And so what's happening from the brain to the gut? A couple of things. Alteration of the mucus and the biofilms inside the GI tract so that it maintains the right space, the right ecological presence, the right ecosystem for these microbes to inhabit. The brain actually is getting messages directly and responding and say, well, we need to change over here. We need to pour some more water over here to get these plants to grow up a little bigger. And you know what? Those star thistle took over that area, so let's go ahead and we're going to need to, like, you know, bring in some goats and chow that star thistle down, and then we'll reseed that with some of this stuff, and then we'll grow up some new plants in there. That's happening in our gut always, and the brain is in direct communication, both brains together, to make it right, to make it work. So altering intestinal permeability. The gut, the brain is actually helping alter the permeability of the gut to allow some things to come through or not allow things to come through. And it's also altering immune function. So this immune function is a dance between both brains, that they're working together to make the immune system do that perfect balancing act between controlling the microbiota and giving them tolerance so that they can be present. So the brain has the ability to sense gut bacteria. That is so cool. When you see the images, like the nerves, the little desmosomes, and then the dendrites that extend into the lumen of the small intestine, right there at the little interface, they're nerves, right there, talking, listening, hearing what's happening with the little microbes. It's so fascinating. I love it. It's right linked to the brain. So both brains are just like connecting directly to what's happening at that interface. Afferent vagus nerve route, we talked about that. That's kind of like that main highway of information coming from the enteric nervous system up to the central nervous system, up through the vagus nerve. We've talked about a lot of this stuff. This was really interesting. This was a hypothesis that was proposed in a paper I read. I read a lot of papers. They weren't boring. No, they were so cool. They were fascinating. They were really cool. But this guy, Stilling, posits that during evolution, microbrain interactions critically influenced brain evolution towards the development of the social brain. Does that make sense? Microbrain interactions critically influence brain evolution towards the development of social brain. It's kind of matrixy, right? It's kind of like, wait, I thought we were doing this thing. I thought we were kind of in control. Socialist?
Yeah.
These socialist microbes. Damn it. Can't get away from them. Through the dendrites that extend into the lumen.
And how is that signal
created? Electromagnetically, electrochemically. Okay. Yep.
That makes sense.
Yep. You know, in the chemical compounds, everyone has a signature, an electromagnetic signature that's then picked up at the dendritic ending, and then that stimulates, you know, a spike initiation of a, you know, basically an influx of ions that then is transmitted into the synapses. Synapses respond and release chemicals across synaptic clefts that are picked up the other side. Signals are sent along the neurons, and it makes it up to the brain. The brain has this incredible way to, well, what's happening there? And we'll send another message back, and that interaction just keeps happening over and over again. CNS induced changes in the gut environment, signaling molecules used by the host for neuronal and neuroendocrine signaling is limited but not limited, not is including but not limited to catecholamines, serotonin, dynorphin, GABA, cytokines. These are cytokines are, you know, immune cell signaling compounds. These can all be released into the gut by the neurons, so the neurons themselves can stimulate the release of all these different compounds. They can actually release them through the synapse right there. It's almost like the gut is another synaptic cleft that we can release these compounds that direct function right into the lumen, and that affects the immune cells, it affects the microbes, and then they respond, and it's, so it's a direct bidirectional communication response, call and response happening all the time. So let's talk about this mucus layer. And don't forget about that social brain thing. That's really cool. And we're going to get more, we're going to go to it. So this is really cool. So the mucus layer, right? So here you have a healthy mucus layer. This is homeostasis. Look, hey, happy bugs. They're all green and everything's good. And they've got like the outer layer of the mucus and then the middle layer of the mucus and then the inner layer of the mucus. And the inner layer is pretty well protected. There aren't many bugs in there. It's mostly chemical compounds, metabolites, things, you know, and these are our little microvilli at the end of our enterochromaffin cells, and everything looks pretty tight here. These little junctions are tight, and the control of what comes in and out is really good, and these are good bugs going in, and they're happy, and they're working with us, and there's, you know, just, it's a really good, it's like a party, and the party's good, and everybody's happy. This one over here, you see these kind of red bugs, they kind of got in, and they were able to penetrate this spot right here because the gut mucus layer is weak here. You can see there's a hole going all the way down to these epithelial cells. And at this point, you can see the epithelial cells start to be separated a little bit. The tight gaps are a little bit weakened. There's a little bit of gapping here. And you see a bacteria actually moving down in there. And you can see here the bacteria are getting really close. They're interacting with the cells. Now imagine now there's neurons coming in here. There's cells with all kinds of, you know, interactive interplay happening with, you know, chemically, and these bugs are getting right in there, and they're starting to interface in a way that's not homeostatic, it's not harmonious for us, it's disruptive to our system. Things are being created that are stimulating our brain in ways that don't feel good. We don't feel good anymore when this gets screwed up. This is like our second brain blood-brain barrier. Yes, sir. We could go back to the altered food supply, the toxic environment, the stress, the overwork, the lack of sleep, the lack of exercise. Specifically, some things will be worse, you know, harder on the mucus layer. And it's going to depend, again, one of the big things is if you have a weak mucus layer, oftentimes it's part of having a weak or dysbiotic, disharmonious microbiota. Because the interface isn't good and the mucus layer isn't being controlled well. The immune system isn't functioning high because the microbiota is not in harmony with us. It's out of harmony. And so now we get weaknesses. And this is just kind of like a simplification. Maybe there's, you know, a weakened mucus layer that's just shrunken down for a person all the way through, like through the whole colon or through the whole small intestine. So there's more penetrative areas. But it's the idea is that inflammation is the main cause, oxidative damage. It could be, absolutely. Yep. I mean, fiber becomes one of the main foods for the bugs that then produce the short-chain fatty acids, which then gives us energy and makes us happy. When we don't have that, we don't have the fiber, we're not able to feed the bugs. So, you know, it's kind of like, you know, inulin and prebiotics and all that kind of good stuff. Yeah, we'll get to all that. So biofilms. So you can see that bacteria don't just generally live as single organisms, even though we study them like that, or you see a picture of one. They actually live, they start out in this planktonic form, and the planktonic form is where they all are kind of existing in sort of a soup, and they're all kind of interacting and doing their thing. Then they adhere to the surface. I'll talk about adhesion to the surface. This would be to that mucus layer. And they adhere in order for them to bring a few more of their friends along who can hear together, and then they form something called a monolayer. And they create this slime, and it's like a bacterial effluent that protects them. Then that slime and that monolayer develops into something called a microcolony, where the cells are now layered and layered and layered, thicker and thicker. So now they've got this big colony of this slime that's protecting these bacteria that are all living together. Then, once they get going in that realm, they start to move on to what's called a mature biofilm, where they actually get into this mushroom-shaped, polysaccharide-based slime city. They build cities and colonies where they live together, just like we do. I mean, that's New York right there. That's like, that's just the World Trade Tower. Yeah, it's like, yeah. So that's what they do, though. And so, it's happening in a way that they do this in order to protect themselves. And you can see there's some other colored guys in here. That means that the other organisms have started to share their biofilms with them because they're actually symbiotic together. So they've created space to bring in other creatures to live with them because it works. Kombucha.
What's the difference between mucus and slime?
I don't know. They call this slime because I think the slime is less viscous. Is kind of what I was thinking. I don't know. But I mean, our mucus layer, I think, is produced by goblet cells that make mucus, and that's what we call it. This slime is probably a little bit of a different material, you know. But it's very protective. The idea is that it holds everything together. It protects them from the immune system. It protects them from other bugs. It protects them from antibiotics. It protects them from all kinds of things. So targeting the biofilm is a big place that a lot of botanical medicine has started to become very focused on because it works. And a lot of antibiotics don't penetrate the biofilms. So communities and biofilms, they establish these communities. I talked about all this. They move from the planktonic to the biofilm in order to provide themselves with a bigger habitat. So, hey, a human biofilm, here it is. This is actually Sardinia, and this is a group of people all eating together, living together, having social interactions, right? Just like the microbes that benefit from each other, we benefit from each other too. The guys who raised the goats that made the feta, that brought it into the table, and the woman who cooked the food, and the man who, you know, chopped up the meat, and the man who harvested the olives and brought the olives to the table, the vintners who made all the wine and brought it there, they're all here at the table. They all did it together, and they're sharing it in a social interaction setting, just like this. And as we know, this is a blue zone, right? One of the blue zones where people live long. They live long and healthy. They live over 100 years, a lot of people. And why is that? Well, one of the real big reasons is because they eat together. They hang out together. They're not paranoid of each other. They actually like each other most of the time. And if they don't, they'll say, "I don't like you." And they'll say, "Really, why?" And they'll say, "Because you did this and this and this." And they'll say, "Okay, cool, are we good? We're good. All right, let's hear, can I have a piece of bread?" That's healthy to me. Moving through the emotional experience. Not like, "I don't know what that guy said. He didn't look at me nice. I'm not going to talk to him. I'm just over here." You know? That whole approach, you know? And I'm seeing this now. You know, you can see a lot of restaurants now, at least in kind of more urban settings, they're starting to have community tables in America, you know, where you sit down, there's this big table. And maybe you're sitting with some other people maybe they're from Germany, maybe they're from Iowa, who knows? But you can have, and you start interacting with them. But one of the keys to health, for sure, the word community, right? Communis. The changes or exchanges that link us. They link us together in a local or an intimate way. It's the act of eating together, sharing the food, sharing close contact with one another. So what's really fascinating is that the microbes, they make 95% of our serotonin. What's serotonin do? What does it do? Relaxing, what else? Non-depressed? What else?
Healthy sleep?
What else? What do you guys think of when you think of serotonin? A burst of serotonin. What would a burst of serotonin feel like?
Joyful?
Raising your spirits. Well, you know what? One of the things that serotonin is really good at is making us feel really comfortable with each other. It's really good. It's about love, really. It's really the love neurotransmitter. It's the I love you, and I can look at you and I can say that without having any wonder about whether you like me or think I'm ugly or not. I'm just going to love you because you're awesome and you're a human being and you've done a lot to get here and it's been hard and I appreciate you and I just want to tell you that. And you know what? And I kind of suck in some ways and that's cool. And you're like, dude, you're awesome. And then we're like, let's have dinner together. And then you're like, yeah, let's hug. Want a hug? Well, I want a hug. Yeah, I'll take a hug. Yeah. Thanks, man. Yeah. Serotonin. So it's found in the GI tract. It's stored in the platelets. And we use it in the central nervous system and in the enteric nervous system. Those little enterochromaffin cells, we're going to see them closer up, they're the ones who make it. They stimulate our body. They stimulate the process of creation of serotonin. And they're stimulated by who? The microbiota that make them do this. Taken up by the central nervous system and is a key part of peristalsis. So serotonin, you know, it's also that feeling of like, you know, you just really have to have a bowel movement. You really need to have a good bowel movement. And you go and have a really good bowel movement. It's like, oh my God, just let all that go. Whatever the worries of the day. Sit there for a moment and just be like, oh man, life is good, you know? Serotonin. And serotonin is what makes you go, and it keeps things moving, you know? So here's the little enterochromaffin cell. You can see this little luminal cell lining, this epithelial cell. There's an enterochromaffin cell. And so you can see this little lady's interacting with this microbiota here, these little bugs, and they're making little bits of metabolites. And it's creating this thing right here, tryptophan hydroxylase, which is hydroxylating tryptophan, to make 5-HTP and to make 5-HT, which is 5-hydroxytryptamine, that's serotonin. And serotonin is then picked up by the nervous system right here, boom, into these Meissner's and Auerbach plexuses, and then brought right up into the central nervous system through the vagus nerve and the preganglial neurons, and it's interacting with our brain. And it's making us feel like we want to be with people or we don't want to be with people. And so when this is screwed up, when these guys aren't happy, when this stuff isn't happening, and this guy's not making this stuff, you don't feel good. It's simple. You don't feel like giving people a hug. You don't feel like hanging out at a dinner table. I'm just going to get my TV dinner. I'm going to watch freaking Wapner. Here's a closer look here, enterochromaffin cell, mucosa, neurons, we got that. So dopamine also though, 50% of the dopamine in our body. So what's dopamine about?
Emotionally feeling good about yourself.
Feeling good about yourself? I think, yeah, yeah. Making good decisions. Muscle rigidity. Okay, so dopamine is the like, you get a flood of dopamine when you made a post on Facebook and you got 800 likes. Dude, like, oh, I'm awesome. Dopamine. You're sitting at the slot machine. Ching, 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 ching. Ding, winner. Dopamine. Yes. That's dopamine. So what is that? Reward. Reward. It's the reward neurotransmitter. It makes you feel like I'm good. So what's really fascinating is that since 50% of it's produced in the gut, we get into this idea of emotional eating. The feeling of reward. So when you feed the bugs that help you make dopamine, the foods that make them make dopamine, you get more dopamine. And a lot of different bugs can make dopamine, but if you set up an ecosystem that's based on a certain type of bug that makes dopamine in response to a certain type of food, like let's say cakes and pies and cookies and ice cream, and you get rewarded. Let's say at the end of a long day of working your job where you're just an employee and you're kind of, you know, kind of boot on head sort of syndrome all day long. You're kind of like, God, I'm not really that good. I'm not really that good. And you go home and you're like, I'm awesome. I feel really good. And you know what happens? And after a while, it leads to a lot of other problems, you know, especially problems with insulin and blood sugar, you know, handling and obesity and diabetes and all kinds of things. And we've seen recently there's a compound called ghrelin, and I've always been fascinated by the adipocytes, right, the fat tissues. They make a whole set of hormones, endocrine hormones. They're secretors. They're literally secreting glands that make these hormones that then stimulate our body to do all kinds of things, especially playing with cholesterol, especially, you know, playing with blood sugar and changing, like, the aromatase enzyme is secreted by fat cells that turns testosterone into estrogen. They have a big role to play. One of the compounds is called ghrelin. It's a peptide hormone here. It's in these ghrelin cells in the stomach and in the gastrointestinal tract. And when you're under long psychosocial stress over a long period of time, you make more ghrelin. The ghrelin then stimulates the dopaminergic receptors and induces this food reward behavior and hyperphagia. It pushes you to this place of, like, as long as I eat the food that makes me feel good, I'm good. This is a big deal. You get stuck in these ruts, man, and people just get stuck, and it's really hard to get them out. And we really need to help people feel good about themselves as one of the main ways to help them get it straightened out, get them off of this food reward situation, because the food reward thing doesn't go very far until it's a food disservice and you're feeling like, you know, the only time you ever feel good is when you're eating your ice cream. So neurotransmitters, we talked about a few of these, 40 in the gut that we know of, dopamine, norepinephrine. These are the catecholamines, epinephrine, serotonin, GABA. GABA is so cool. It calms the nervous system down, right? GABA is gamma-aminobutyric acid, and it just, when you stimulate it, when you agonize the receptor, it calms everybody down. It calms down the rest of the neurotransmitters. It just chills it out. Acetylcholine, that's our muscle conductor, keeps brain function flow, keeps the flow in the neurons, keeps the muscles moving. It sort of like keeps everything, you know, buttered up. Oxytocin, we know what that one's about, you know. It's a big part of birth. It's a big part of kissing and breastfeeding, and it's a big part of feeling really good about yourself. It's also generated in the gut. Oh, wow. Interesting. Bacteria that make brain chemicals. Here's just a few of what we know right now. Specific bacteria. Do you guys have this diagram?
Yeah.
Yeah, cool. So the thing that, you know, of course you see this diagram and you're like, oh, cool, well, that patient needs some dopamine. I'm going to give him bacillus. Yeah, that'll work. Well, it doesn't really work that easy. It's not like you can just give him bacillus and do it that way. But it's cool to see how this is happening. And you see that, you know, serotonin is made by the enterococcus and the escherichia. Those guys, they make serotonin. The streptococcus makes serotonin. And you can see that the GABA producers, bifido and lactobacillus, these are the two primary symbiotic, mutualistic organism genuses that we have in our gut. And they make GABA. How cool is that? If we had a lot of them and feeling really good, we'd be calm. And I'll tell you, calming the central nervous system is about the number one thing probably that I do for my patients outside of making sure that their gut is healthy. So fix the gut, calm the central nervous system, and you will get a large percentage of your patients well, even if you don't know the name of their disease. Newsflash. Da-da-da-da. Emerging evidence indicates that disruption of the gut microbial community, dysbiosis, impairs mental health. Wow. Antibiotic-induced gut dysbiosis leads to impaired object recognition in mice. It's a good thing we're studying mice to figure this out. Yeah, this just fascinates me because, you know, like I said, 2,000 years ago, it was like, hey guys, your mind is in your gut. You feel good because your spleen's working good, and you don't feel good because your spleen isn't working good. So you are what you eat. Who said that? Right? And I say, if you are what you eat, digest, assimilate, you know, absorb. So let's talk about depression in the gut. We've got these GF mice means germ-free. So the big thing in gastroenteroenterology is to study germ-free mice. They're literally germ-free. They don't have any germs. They don't have any bugs. They've been like isolated, and they never were vaginally birthed. They never got breastfed. They never had exposure with any other animals. They don't have bugs. And so they study them and say, well, what do? Well, they're antisocial. They don't hang out with other people. Well, that's pretty cool, right? We talked about bugs making serotonin, making us hang out with each other. Well, when you don't have bugs, you don't hang out with each other. You just hang out by yourself. They don't remember things very well. They get lost in the mazes. They don't figure things out. The bugs, guys. The bugs make us figure things out. They're reckless. Hey, stop doing things. So rats that were given stool from depressed humans got depressed. Is that fascinating? You're like, this person's been clinically diagnosed with depression. All right, we'll give your poop to some rats. The rats are like, oh man, life sucks. What? It's so cool. Rats given stool from non-depressed humans. No change in behavior. They're just like, yeah, that was some human poop. Probably not my favorite, but, you know, it's fine. The Walkerton flood. This was a Walkerton, Canada. They had a big flood that came through, and everybody got sick for like 10 days. And there happened to be a bunch of psychologists that were kind of following what's happening in that town. It was a big thing. I mean, a big litigation deal, whatever. And people went to jail or whatever because they had screwed up the water supply. But it turned out that the people there had exceptionally high rates of depression 10 years later. Because they were dysbiotic to start with. They didn't have that diverse, resilient microbiota. So when they got hit with the big burst of the infection, an organism that took over, it just established itself and just never really let go. And they never fully recovered back to that feeling good place of, yeah, all of my bugs are helpful and it's all working together and I'm, you know, I'm good. They never got back there. So they're always a little bit depressed now. No, well, I mean, they didn't. I mean, these guys were just kind of following. Psychologists were checking in on people. They just had patients, and there were some medical hospitals, and somehow they all got connected to seeing, like, oh, they started recording. Well, why do we have such high rates of depression around here? And then they went back to Walkerton and said, oh, the flood, and oh, yeah, that's really interesting. And then so they kind of made a paper that just talked about how this connection was there. And this was a while back, so, you know, now we're much more further along. We'd be like, oh, duh. You know, but again, it's not that everybody had that happen. Not everybody. A percentage, a higher percentage than you would have expected. And that means that a lot of those people just didn't have a strong initial gut flora. Here's a simple study. There's really not a whole lot of human studies yet. This whole, you know, gastroenteroenterology is just coming up and the studies are just starting to come out. So one of the earlier studies here is that 22 healthy men took a probiotic pill containing Bifidobacterium longum for a month. What happened? Well, they felt less stress. They had lower levels of cortisol, and they measured this when they were stressed out. They actually had a better stress response just because they were given a probiotic. So when we are talking about this connection between the brain, our mind, and the enteric nervous system and the biota, we're going beyond brain chemistry here. And that the living memory of our traumas, our associations, and the things we're addicted to is not just woven into our neurological system. It's not just the issues are in the tissues. The issues are in the microbes. It's a living memory, of what's happened to us in our lives. Addiction. Addiction has been wonderfully tied now to problems with the microbiota. So a person who has a non-diverse, non-resilient microbiota population, is under a lot of stress, had a bunch of traumas early in life, starts drinking alcohol. Feels pretty good. Well, that person's going to have a hard time not drinking alcohol, because that feeling of good on alcohol is going to get associated with the way that the bugs adapt to this new compound. So now you've got all this alcohol coming in, it changes the populations. The populations shift. And the population is like, oh, well, this works for me now. This is how I am. This is what we are. And it feels good. Those people then need the alcohol to feel that good moment when the bugs are actually in that configuration that made them feel good when they first had the alcohol. Down the road, when they don't have the alcohol, they don't feel good. So check it out. There's a study that looked at 60 people. It gave a bunch of these people an assessment for intestinal permeability. You can assess that a few different ways. They basically described the people who had gut permeability that was elevated, so leaky gut, and the people who didn't, put them into two different groups. These folks were all alcoholics. They were basically put on a 19-day sobriety fast. Okay, the 26 people who had reduced gut flora on their stool analysis and a leaky gut syndrome still had high scores for depression, anxiety, and alcohol cravings after 19 days. None of them got better. The 34 subjects with normal gut flora recovered much better, scoring low on depression, anxiety, and craving scores. Another way to show that the gut microbiota alter the gut barrier function and influence the behavior in alcohol dependence. Just another layer to see. Addiction is going to be something that, you know, you see how some people are like, oh, I've got an addictive personality, or I don't, you know. A person who doesn't have an addictive personality, oftentimes, those are people that have a very resilient microbiota. And people who don't connect their addiction to their traumas oftentimes don't get addicted as much. And people whose addictions are connected to their traumas have a very hard time getting out of their addictions. And I'm just taking it to the next level again, that it's not just the nervous system, it's the enteric nervous system and the microbiota. How does genetics play into this? I mean, it has everything to do with how everything we're talking about functions, and you know how our immune system functions. And you know, we know that foods, chemicals, things alter genes through the single nucleotide polymorphisms, right? Through what basically the SNPs, and those are the part of the epigenetics, how genes function. You know, the human genome is going to be pretty stable over long periods of time, but how the genes are functioning, whether they're altered or they're functioning at a high level, at a normal level, that's changeable in a lifetime. That's changeable in part of a lifetime. That's changeable by the foods we eat. That's changeable by the alcohol we drink. That's changeable by the thoughts that we have. So genetics play a huge role in it, you know. Not the genes, but the epigenetics, really.
What part does sugar play in that?
Well, sugar is... Alcohol, yeah, well, it's not really sugar, but it's alcohol, right? It has a similar effect, and it's absorbed right through the stomach lining. It's affecting the gut as it goes along. Sugar is, you know, to me, it's the biggest insult to our society. So I'm going to hit it hard later on. How far are we going to go here before we get to... Oh, autism's coming right up here anyway. It's coming right up here. So I want to go back to early life. She was just talking about the connection with autism and the microbiota in the gut, and that's it's huge. So early life microbiome dynamics. So having a vaginal birth, you get exposed to all the microbes, okay? It's super important. And some people have woken up to this, some doctors, some you know OBGYN folks, and they're actually swabbing the woman's vagina and then getting the kid connected with all those microbes. That's super important. That's the first touch of the microbiome that you have. That's it. That's all the genes, all the bugs you're going to have to start out with as you're a developing baby. So a developing baby is developing a nervous system. It's developing a digestive system. It's developing an immune system. And those things, you can see, how deeply woven is that to the microbiota? It's huge. If you don't have the bugs that make serotonin, you're not going to get it. And then at the same time, you're left in your crib because the doctor said, hey, you know, don't, your baby just needs to grow up. Your baby just needs to stay in the crib and just cry itself out. So you walk away. The baby didn't get breastfed. Let's say they got formula, right? Well, formula doesn't do what breast milk does. Breast milk has, of course, first the colostrum, which gives you a big burst of immunoglobulins. Then the breast milk itself is a food that those first bugs are ready to digest. They're designed to digest human milk. They're not designed to digest, you know, proteins from corn and soy and proteins from goat milk. I mean, that's probably like the next best thing if you couldn't get it. But formulas have many, many problems for the developing infants. It changes their microbiota and it changes their nervous system. And it has a huge impact on the downstream development of the human being. So some of the things that just kind of prove it out, you know, just that the microbiota of a woman and her child, her infant, are very similar. Kinship is involved in determining the composition of the gut microbiota. In mice, the microbiota of offspring is closely related to that of their mothers. So it's an obvious truth that mom gives you the bugs. And of course, if mom's bugs are really screwed up, well, you know, you're going to get some screwed up bugs. And we're going to talk about Natasha Campbell McBride, the woman who put on the GAPS diet, yeah, she was all about it. She was all about this. And she said, you know, she saw thousands of patients, and she would always go from the pediatric case of the ADD, autism, whatever it was, and then go to the mom and say, yeah, the mom already had the problems early on. So breast milk versus formula, this is easy to see. You know, in Canada, babies drinking formula have bacteria in their gut that are not seen in breastfed babies until solid foods are introduced. So you've got a bunch of bugs that are there that shouldn't really be there. And what are they doing? They're influencing your nervous system development. They're influencing your immune system development. And they're becoming a living memory of whatever is happening in your life at that time. And it's becoming like a fixed So I always think of the nervous system as being more fixed than the muscular system, right? You know, like you go play tennis or you play golf or you play pool or whatever it is that you might do. You do anything, ping pong, and the nerves get built up over time as you do that activity over years. The muscles get built up in the short order as you kind of do the thing and you get really good at it in the moment. But the muscles, if you don't do it, they'll fade away. But you go and play the game and you hadn't played it in years, suddenly you're like, man, I'm an ace, because the nerves are still there. As soon as you start thinking about it and then you screw it up and you can't play as well anymore, that happens. But there's a nervous development that happens at a deeper level that then directs the tissue development around it. And it has to do with how you use it and how you develop the tissue that way. The nervous system that develops around the microbiota is exceptionally important, and it gets very well established, and it's harder to shift. So IBS, irritable bowel syndrome, we all know about this, right? It's the most common gastrointestinal disorder affecting 5 to 27% of the Western society. You got the pain, bloating, cramping, distension, fullness, acid regurg, heartburn, you know, all those things that come. These things are part of IBS, and it's sort of like we've already checked them out. They don't have inflammatory bowel disease. We don't know what the cause is, but there's something going on where they're just not having good bowels. Their bowel health isn't there. But then it also deals with the fact that they don't feel good in their head either. They get depressed easier. The folks who have irritable bowel often have other emotional struggles that go along with their bowel struggles. Some of the precursors, the gut infection or extreme stress in a child's earliest years. There was one study they did. They took apes, chimpanzees, and they took a chimpanzee and they took its poop and they said, oh, okay, here's the poop. This is what it looks like. It's very diverse. Looks like normal chimpanzee poop. Then they took the chimpanzee away from its mom, early age, like 3 days old. Removed it from its mom for like a week. Chimpanzee's like, ah, mom! They sampled its poop. Totally different. Completely changed the microbiota. Then, excuse me. Then of course they, you know, after a little while, they gave it back to the mom, and then everything normalized again. Hey, don't get me wrong. I hate these studies. I'm trying to say we already know all this stuff. Why are we studying animals like and killing them and things and torturing them? It's terrible. Stress, liver qi stagnation. We're going to talk about that Chinese medicine concept, and then the FODMAPs diet. I'm going to hit that one. That's sort of like one of these really interesting. It's a diet that's based on treating IBS in Australia, but it actually really helps us understand some of the causes of IBS and kind of how we can treat it and what are some of the underlying things. You're talking about fiber and, you know, mono. And we'll get to it. Anyway, okay, so the HBA axis. I want to talk about stress and the gut-brain axis because this is all linked together. You have your hypothalamic, pituitary, thyroid, adrenal axis, right? And that's all linked directly in the neuroendocrine system, directly linked into the endocrine network, and then directly linked into the microbiota, the luminal cells, and what happens in the connection between them. So you can tell we have such a clear relationship between programming the HPA axis in early life and reacting to stress over the lifespan. So if, as a child, and I always say this to my patients way before I started studying all this, you know, gastroenterology stuff, I was always saying to people, like, you know, you develop the kidney adrenal network in the first 2 years of your life. That's where it comes from. And I really heard that first from a guy, Dr. Tom. He teaches at the Naturopathic College in Portland. Great guy. And he was always telling, you know, people about how the development of the kidney adrenal network, that's that foundational place. It's based on rhythm, timing. It's all about you wake up in the morning, you have all your needs met. You have food. You go to the potty. You have mom. You got love. Everything's stable. It's good. You feel good. That establishes that adrenal kidney network into a place of calm, relaxed presence, not a place of like, oh my God, am I going to get the next thing? Oh my God, that noise is too loud. Oh my God, I'm scared. What's going to happen to me next? Am I going to get hurt? Someone going to yell at me? That gets established. Those traumas get established into the adrenal and kidney system to where it's destabilizing to the foundational fear, stress system, so that you start to become fearful, anxious, and easily upset in life. So now we know that it's woven right down in to this population of microbes, into the gut, into the enteric nervous system. And the developmental period coinciding with intestinal bacterial colonization is so important. So help all your friends who are having babies and people you know, make sure they understand how powerful their impact is on the child today in that first year and a half or 2 years of life. because it's hard to undo that stuff. It's hard to undo it. Much easier to just not do it than to do it and then undo it later. And I'm always telling my patients that. It's just another way to say, you know, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. It's the same story. So the HPA, it's just such an incredible weave that's happening. In germ-free mice again, right, the hypothalamic pituitary axis was dysregulated. Their stress response was way out of line. They had decreased perception of inflammatory pain. They were unable to tell if they were having a problem. Pain is coming through that serotonin system, the pain in our guts. We need that. That's our stimulation to let us know something's wrong. We've got to have a bowel movement, or we've got to do something. We need a treatment. We've got to change something. We need pain. The brain-gut enteric microbiota axis is bidirectional, and it's connected through the HPA. Abnormal stimulation of the ENS equals IBS and depression. So stress management, here's a nice slide just for managing stress. Regulate the HPA. Make sure you get people doing rhythmic life. Sleep at a normal time. Get the same hours of sleep. Eat at a good time. Eat at the same time. How simple. It makes a big difference. If your body doesn't have to go, I don't know when I'm getting food. I don't know what's going to happen. Oh, suddenly, oh, there's food. Okay, I'm going to make all the compounds and do everything I need to do to eat. If your body's already like, oh, yeah, here comes that time. The time of day is shifting. Oh, food is coming. Good. Easy preparation. It's easy on the body. It's not stressful. When eating becomes stressful, it's not good eating. Calm the central nervous system. Lots of ways to do that. We're herbalists. We're great at that, right? We have such a big toolbox to calm the nervous system. Create an ecosystem that supports the microbes. Do the meditation. You guys, meditation, I mean, there's just nothing better. I mean, what could connect you better to your enteric nervous system, to your first brain, than just sitting and calming down, calming your mind? I always say it's like this is the tool, right? This mind, this incredible tool we have. But we're so fascinated with the tool, we never want to put it down. We're so fascinated with all the things in it that we just sprawl them out. You see how your little one-year-old's like, da, 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 there's stuff everywhere. It's your pile like, da, fun, da, yeah. You know, it's like that's how our brains are. Look at the next thing. Oh, my God, it's so exciting. Oh, it's a little toy that does, look, it's a laser. Look. Ah, wow, so cool. If we could just, you know, you tell your baby, you say, sweetheart, put all your toys away. Okay, we're going to go to bed now. We're just going to go do something else. So what do? We don't put the toys away. We don't do that. We just like sprawl. Our minds are just sprawled. We go to bed. We're just like, the dreams. It's just crazy. If we could put all the tools back into the toolbox, put them all down, close the toolbox, put the thing on it, lock away. Let's put it over here. Let's put it down. You're like, wow, no more tools. Could actually be aware for a minute? Live in the present for a second? Can we give that to our patients? Can we give that to ourselves? Put away the tools for a minute. Don't worry, they're going to be there. I think that's one of the fears. People are so afraid that if they put all the tools away, they won't know how to find them again. Man, don't worry. They'll be jumping out at you. They're all right there. As soon as you open that toolbox, yeah, the party! So I just think meditation, and it's not an easy thing to do for the American mind, but it's something that we all need to do. And if it just stop for a minute and breathe. Just stop for a minute. Just all you need to do. I'm just going to breathe. And what does that mean? It means just breathe. Literally, just watch your breath. And do that for a few cycles. And you'll notice that you're like, oh, yeah, I got to get that paycheck. I got to get that check off to the guy, and I need to go to the bank. And you're like, whoa, wait a minute. I was just breathing. Oh, cool. I'll just keep breathing. Next thought comes up. Look at that tree over there. Oh, my God, I was supposed to trim the branch. And I'm not going to have the cherries I wanted this year. Whoa. No, I'm supposed to be just sitting here, just breathing, right? So you come back and you just start breathing again. And just, if you do that for 5 minutes a day, you just did yourself so much of a service. Seriously. Yeah?
I've always had a problem with meditating, and my mentor mentioned this cool podcast called Headroom. It's free.
Headroom?
Headroom.
So there's a cool podcast called Headroom. I can't go into it because I've got to keep moving on, but Headroom. Yeah. Headroom, helpful, because we got a lot of toys and they're all spread out all over the house. So we got to clean them up and be able to hang out with them without playing with them for a minute. I got some stuff in here for rescuing the kidney adrenal axis. The KEA is the kidney essence adrenals. A couple years ago I did some talks on that system. You can use adrenal glandulars. We can use adaptogenic support, constitutional formulas, use the right nutrients, give them what they need, get the dietary intervention in place, use bone broth. We'll talk about that more. Integrate their structure, make sure they're, you know, everything's working on their, you know, muscle tightness, bone problems, joint problems. Get everything lined up for them. And then whole adrenal I just used for short periods of time. This goes back again to traditional medicine. A lot of glandulars were used. It's a very easy thing to use. It's very helpful. I use an organic free-range source, and I just have people take it for a short period of time. It breaks the feedback loop between the hypothalamus and the adrenal for a minute, just to say, hey, stop asking the adrenal for stuff. Because the hypothalamus will tell the pituitary to stimulate that adrenocorticotropic releasing hormone, and then the adrenal's going, okay, I got it. And it's like, okay, really? I give up. And then that's when I say, okay, break it. Throw in the glandular, and it just says, I'm not going to ask you anymore. The hypothalamus is like, cool, we got what we need. And the adrenal's like, oh, wow, really? Nobody's asking me for stuff? This is great. And then the adrenal's like, yeah, this is cool. We'll go to the gym, start hanging out. The adrenal gets strong again, and it's like, okay. And then you take away the adrenals, and then the hypothalamus says, okay, we need some. And the adrenal's like, cool, I got you. And just starts pumping it up. And that really works. It's really a cool way to go. Got some dosing on here for you guys, too. Here's some adrenal normalizing botanicals. Love these. All these herbs. I'm going to hit Panax ginseng a lot more. Schizandra really more like stabilizes. It holds the essence. Yes, sir. I mean, like, literally indigenous people using glandulars for, you know, as long as we can remember into our history. That, you know, you look at native tribes in this culture would eat the heart. You know, someone would get the heart, someone would get the kidneys. They wouldn't separate the adrenals, but when you were really weak and deficient, you'd get the kidney. You'd eat the kidney as a glandular. Chinese medicine always, like, for kidney problems, you'd eat kidney. You know, if you had stomach, you know, if you had spleen problems, you'd eat spleen. You take the part of the body that you needed help with. Does that answer your question? Cool. Rhodiola rosea, it's another one that's astringent. These two are both astringent. They help to kind of hold the essence in the adrenals. And one thing about the adrenals, the concept from Chinese medicine is that you have essence. You have so much of it you have in your life. It's stored in the kidneys. To me, the adrenals are basically the command centers of the essence. They tell the kidneys how much essence to give out in a moment. And if you use up a lot of essence real fast, sort of like what's in your main fuel tank gets low, really low. Even though you might have more in your reserves, it takes time to get it from the reserves into the fuel tank. And if you deplete that fuel tank really quick, you get really sick because you don't have the steroidal action, you don't have the cortisol you need to put out the fires of life. And when you're living, you're constantly creating fires because we're burning sugar in the presence of oxygen. We're like, you know, in every cell in our body, we've got a trillion little stars burning fuel. We have an oxidative damage process happening that we're constantly quenching with superoxide dismutase and glutathione and thyroid auxin. Our quenching network is essential. But when that quenching network breaks down because the kidneys and adrenals got weakened too quickly due to the stress, the anxiety, the worry, the foods, the toxins, man, you don't have what you need to put out the fires, and they start raging out of control. So, licorice, I'll just say one thing. I mean, it's such a cool herb. It's gotten a lot of weird press because of its, you know, because of its effect on blood, you know, on blood pressure and water retention. It's really doesn't do that very often, and I've given so many people licorice. You know, it's not a big problem for the blood sugar. It's really this stuff, glycyrrhizic acid, has an ability to spare cortisol. It inhibits the 17 beta hydroxysteroid enzyme and allows there to be more cortisol in the body. In a certain subgroup of people, it can cause this thing called pseudo hyperaldosteronism, where they do hold a little extra fluid. All the cases of people having big problems with licorice, you know what they were? They were either people drinking huge amounts of tea or eating huge amounts of licorice candy. If you go and dig and do the research into PubMed, you'll find woman ate 18 packs of licorice. Well, yeah. Now, okay, so licorice is a problem, you know. These herbalists are crazy. They use this stuff, you know. I think it's a good place to take a break. You guys good?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Headspace, everybody.
Headspace. Oh, the name of the podcast?
Headspace.
Headspace for meditation.